Someday we're going to look back at our spray and pray approach to healthcare as rather primitive. So every individual is unique, and applying the same treatment across all humans and expecting the same outcome makes little sense. So in the future, we're going to move towards precision medicine, or what they also call personalized medicine. In particular, when it comes to cancer treatment, cancer isn't just some single entity. There are over 200 types of cancer, and every instance of cancer is unique to the person that has it. So today's company, Tempus, is planning on having an IPO, and here they tell you right up front, AI-enabled precision medicine, bringing the power of data and AI to healthcare. AI is actually used 228 times throughout their S1. And we're not entirely unfamiliar with Tempus. So back in 2020, they were listed as one of the top 10 AI startups in the world, alongside names like UiPath and C3, both of which are now public. And we had first looked at Tempus back in 2019. You see this piece. You can search our website for both these articles. This one is on 7 AI cancer diagnostics startups digitizing healthcare. And then we followed that up with this piece on Tempus. It's titled Tempus Uses AI and Big Data for Precision Medicine. So they were doing back then what they say they're doing now. So we know that at least to a certain extent, they're not taking too much advantage of the AI hype. So prior to AI being on everyone's lips, Tempus was working on AI-driven cancer diagnostic capabilities and data-driven cancer treatment customized for each patient. So personalized medicine or precision medicine. They were partnering with companies or firms, organizations to access large data sets. They had pivoted into COVID, which we never really liked it when firms did that, though I suppose it provided them with some money to continue down their main mission. They were working on applying their AI platform across a range of other healthcare initiatives, from cardiology to mental health. And the researcher who wrote this piece said there's the risk of overpromising results across too many verticals. That same concern may hold true today, though we're going to look at that, and especially in the context of cardiology. So we had concluded that piece saying in a couple of years, we could probably write a whole new story about Tempus. And indeed, that's what we're going to do today. We're going to take a fresh look at what they've been up to. And I always like to start by looking at the first sentence of the S1. And here you can see I've taken the old strike through and trimmed this down into something that's more understandable. So they say, we unlock the power of precision medicine by creating intelligent diagnostics which use AI to make laboratory tests more accurate, tailored, and personal. Everyone these days seems to think AI is new, but it's not. It's been around for a while, which means plenty of older AI companies are now going to start using the term du jour, generative AI, a whole bunch, and then they'll move to start raising capital at frothy valuations. Indeed, we can see here that they've slipped in to the unedited mission statement, the use of generative AI. Now, this is a good thing because, as McKinsey tells us, the companies that stand to benefit the most from generative AI are those that already had AI initiatives. So when we look at what Tempus does, they have three revenue segments. Genomics. So here you can see they're doing next generation sequencing tests. So they had 288,000 samples in 2023, what they describe as lab services. Let's put that into context. So Guardant Health, a company that also engages in precision oncology, they're also a firm that we're holding. They had reported 202,800 tests in 2023. Their full year revenue came in at $564 million, and $514 of that was precision oncology. So they're a formidable competitor, at least in respect to that segment. And then when we look at the second segment for Tempus, data and services, so they say our database of multimodal de-identified records has grown to be more than 50 times the size of the Cancer Genome Atlas, which is the largest public genomic data set that they know of. Within that segment is also what they call AI applications. They say we can leverage this data set as a proprietary training data set for generative AI applications of their own, of course. So what data set are they talking about? Well, here it is in a nutshell. So you see they have 7.7 million clinical records. They also have imaging data that they, I believe, acquired through the acquisition of another firm, which was, I believe, looking at medical images and figuring out what the ailments were. You see clinical and molecular data, and then they have, of course, 970,000 samples sequenced. So this is rather innovative. So you see here that they do some sequencing work. So this is from 2018 to 2023. Back in 2018, they did $9 million in sequencing revenue. And then, you know, that's part of that segment. But then what they do is they take the data that they received from that, shove it into the data and services segment, and then start reaping data revenue from it over the years. You can see how that steps up. So the lifetime value of a particular sequencing effort is much longer than just the revenue they get from doing the sequencing. And I think this statement they make on networking effects is pretty accurate. So they say the more data we collect, the smarter our tests become, the more applications we can launch, the more physicians join our network, further growing our database, making our tests smarter and our database more valuable for researchers. So what it all comes down to, of course, always is revenue growth. And we can see that they have very strong revenue growth. So that AI segment is tucked into data and services. So we're just left looking at genomics and data and services. So genomics grew 83% year over year. Data and services grew 39%. So very strong numbers. When we look at how profitable these are at a gross margin level, you see the gross margin for genomics testing is intuitively lower at 48%, while licensing data and services, that's up at 66%. And they have a blended gross margin of 54% this year. That's down from 59% last year. Why? Because genomics revenues increase at a much higher rate than data and services, bringing that margin down. One would think that over time, as they aggregate more and more data, that data and services will become a larger component, at least in terms of profitability, than genomics. Now, let's look at each of these segments, starting with genomics. You see here they say, we operate robotic sequencing labs that allow us to operate as a high-quality, low-cost NGS provider that broadly serves the market. That's great. And for anybody that's technically inclined, they list out their primary assays here. You could check those out. They say that unlike other diagnostic testing providers, many of their tests are connected to clinical data in some manner, which allows their suite of tests to be self-learning. All right, fair enough. Now, when we look at the data and services segment, this is quite interesting. There's three components to this, all right? Insights, so this is the linked clinical, molecular, and imaging de-identified data that we talked about. Then they have this component here called time. So this is clinical trial matching. And then they have their AI segment. So they didn't have much in the form of AI revenues, just $5.5 million last year. But that's up 292% over the previous year when they only saw $1.4 million. So that's a skate to where the puck will be situation. There's an opportunity that they can exploit there. When it comes to insights, you can see that's growing the slowest of the three at 33%. And then you have this trial matching segment growing at 46%. The other thing to note here is that insights products have a higher margin of approximately 76% gross margin compared to trials, this clinical trials product, which had a margin of approximately 42%. So you'd want to see insights growing faster. The net revenue retention rate for insights is 125%. So digging in the S1, you find some interesting little tidbits. That's something to keep an eye on. It means that existing clients are paying more. And I wanted to quickly touch on the trial matching segment, their subsegment time. You can see here they say that this is an AI-enabled solution to accelerate the connection between patients, clinical trial providers, and pharmaceutical companies. So this is basically a matching system. You could probably build this without the need of AI, so it seems like that may be a little bit forced. I'd like to hear arguments saying why AI allows them to do anything special here other than connect patients with clinical trials. So in my own personal experiences, knowing people that have had cancer, I've tried to find clinical trials that they could participate in, because when you have cancer and you have a very short time left, you're willing to try anything, and the family's desperately looking for something. And in the past, I think it's been difficult for them to find the latest clinical trial, because they'll try anything. They're more than happy to enroll themselves in just about anything as a last chance. So it used to take 6 to 12 months from when a trial was initiated to when a patient would give their consent. And with this system from Tempus, it's approximately 14 business days to when the activation is initiated to complete it. So it's much more efficient on both sides. It's a form of a matchmaking system there. I'm curious to how much AI is involved there. Now, you may ask the question, what are they doing in that little AI segment? They saw $5.5 million in revenues last year. Well, that's rather interesting. So in March of last year, they acquired a firm called Empiric. And what Empiric is doing is identifying patients with undiagnosed and untreated cardiovascular disease. And what they then do is identify treatment gaps. So they're diagnosing people based on medical data and then identifying any of 60 potential treatment gaps. That's what Tempus is doing with this acquisition. So pretty slick. They acquired this firm that was doing that, and they plugged in their huge set of data, and suddenly revenues are going from $1.4 million to $5.5 million in a single year. So it will be interesting to see where the ceiling is for that. And perhaps what's most compelling is that's just one of many potential applications of generative AI that they could tack on to a data set. Remember that AI algorithms are only as good as the big data that you feed them. So the other thing I noted in looking at their financials, which is worth mentioning, is this interest expense. So of course, they're burning through a lot of cash. We're going to talk about that. But they have this interest expense last year of around $47 million. And then dividends they're paying on preferred shares of around $44.5 million. So essentially, you have an interesting set of $90 million in cash they're burning through here. They have some funky debt terms that really merit a closer look. And those involve Ares Capital Corporation, that actually has some covenants that say they have to hit certain revenue targets. Who knows why they would put themselves in that sort of a situation. And also a Google note that's worth looking at. And I think this just points to perhaps a company that has been willing to allow for some pretty creative ways to raise capital. Now, the bright side here is that they have a very clever business model. So they sell a testing product, they license data that they get from selling that testing product, they harvest fees from that data for years to come, then they develop proprietary products on said data sets. Now, they call themselves an AI company because they can. They've been doing this for a while, and they've been classified as such. It's not like they're going out of their way to appear as AI, though I think it's worth noting the extent to which they're generating revenues from that AI segment, which is very low at the moment. Now, when it comes to competition, in respect to genomics, you see some names listed here of particular interest: Guardant Health, because we're holding that. So I think a to-do in the future would be to compare these two companies a little bit closer. And then in respect to data and services, they mention IQVIA Holdings. That happens to be a company that we like. Now, you can go look up our many articles on Guardant by searching our website, and we've also covered IQVIA at least once. It's a company we like. So the IPO details, provided that it moves forward as planned, they're looking to raise $100 million. Here's what's interesting. They had $101 million in negative cash flows last quarter. They burned through $100 million, right? They're looking to raise $100 million. They have $81 million in cash left over. They burned through $214 million last year. How long is $100 million going to last them? Is this an act of desperation or some carefully planned out exit? I'm not sure, but Some thoughts on this offering. I think looking under their kimono was edifying in terms of understanding what a company like Gardant or any other company could do with the data that they're gathering. If they're able to de-identify it and sell it, there's lots of talk about this being an advantage for firms like Teladoc and such. I'm very curious why they're cutting it so close on cash. I don't know if I've seen that before. That's a little bit suspect. Is that $100 million they're trying to raise really going to move the needle that much? So I think that right now there's no point in analyzing this further until the IPO actually happens. Then we're going to wait for the dust to settle, at least until they have a regulatory filing, and then see what's up. Now, I know that's a little bit of a letdown for those of you that were looking to invest in an AI IPO, so maybe you'll find the last piece we did on this topic interesting. So whenever there's an AI IPO, we'll be covering it. This last one is quite hyped. It still is. Please subscribe to this channel, as we'll be covering all AI IPOs going forward. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this today.